Hey guys, Chitofa Hadings here for the beginning of Module 2 of the Anamorphic Cookbook. In Module 1, I talked a bunch about the origins of the anamorphic format and anamorphic lenses, and how you can use those to boost the production value of your work. If you missed that, well, that's on you. But there's a playlist that you can use to catch up. Also, huge thanks to Atlas Lens Co., who made possible for me to give you this content free of charge. They're literally coming through on their mission, anamorphic for all. Module 2 focuses on anamorphic optics, which is kind of a generic name, so sorry. The first video is about the differences between anamorphic lenses and adapters. Then we'll go on to talk about the cine versus consumer lenses, different focus mechanisms, stretch factors, and wrap up discussing if it's better to own or rent gear. So let's get into it. Anamorphic lenses or anamorphic adapters. If you look up either on eBay, you're likely to see similar, if not identical, results. Although these names are used interchangeably, lenses and adapters are not the same thing. An anamorphic lens is a complete setup composed of a spherical component and an anamorphic component, which together produce a focused image onto the sensor or film plane. An anamorphic adapter by itself can't do that. Fun fact, people tend to mistakenly call anamorphic adapters lenses, but no one will ever call an anamorphic lens an adapter. Anamorphic lenses are what Atlas offers, or Panavision, Hawk, and Cook, among others. In the more affordable tier, what Vaizen, SLR Magic, or Suray offer. They're the whole thing. You just plug your camera behind and you're good to go. You have one focus ring and one aperture ring. Anamorphic lenses usually come in sets, and you hear a lot of people rave about how expensive they are. I mean, most of the time they're not wrong. Panavisions aren't sold, just rented. Hawks and Cooks and Aries all sell for upwards of $40,000. Atlas kind of broke the market when they started selling for just under 10 grand, and winning awards for Muse Shooter in 2017 and Product of the Year at NAB Las Vegas in 2019. Super cheap anamorphic lenses make a lot of people skeptical. That's the general feeling about smaller companies like Suray or Vaizen, because of how affordable their lenses are in comparison. The big deal with lenses is they tend to come with a mount. For the big guys, that's PL, the default mount for cinema cameras. More recently, in 2018, Atlas popularized the EF mount for cine anamorphics as well, since they're more affordable than their competitors and many of their users run EF mount cameras. Atlas lenses still come in PL as default though. When you start coming down the budget line, you start to see different camera mounts. Suray offers mirrorless mounts, such as MFT or E-mount, and Vaizen's first set only works in MFT. These can't be adapted to many other cameras other than their native mounts, but we'll talk more about that later in Module 3. The bottom line is that anamorphic lenses are designed for certain camera specs. They're made for a specific sensor size and lens mount, and you can't just modify or retrofit them to your liking. I mean, theoretically, you can, but if you had that kind of money, you probably wouldn't be watching this course. Anamorphic adapters, on the other hand, are afocal systems, just like wide-angle adapters or telephoto converters. In practical terms, that means they can't focus light into a picture. They can't produce an image by themselves. An example I like to use is if we have a light source in the ceiling, I can use any spherical lens to create a projected image of that light onto a surface. In this case, the counter works as the focus plane. But if I try doing the same with an anamorphic adapter, I get nothing. This means that if we try putting an anamorphic adapter in front of a camera sensor, we'll never get a picture. They just squeeze the image, and on the bright side, they don't cause any loss of light like many filters do. For us to see what they're doing though, we'll need a focusing component, which is the spherical lens that we put behind the anamorphic adapter. That's what's called a taking lens, and all anamorphic adapters need one. Adapters can be remixed, modified, adjusted, experimented on, and swapped with ease. And while they were originally intended as the main focus of this course, I realized I'd be overlooking a huge portion of anamorphic shooters who use actual lenses. So I adjusted the program to cover all sorts of anamorphic image-making devices. Although they are afocal systems, adapters still need to match the focus of the taking lens, so you can see something on the camera. I'll expand on how focus works for anamorphics later in this module. But for now, let's sink the idea that you have to focus two pieces of gear when using anamorphic adapters: your taking lens and anamorphic adapter, instead of just one when using any lenses, spherical or anamorphic. Kaitien's original anamorphic lens was in fact an adapter, and as so, the early CinemaScope productions like The Robe would have two first ACs for a single camera. One of them would pull focus on the anamorphic adapter, and the other one would focus the taking lens simultaneously. Adapters used to be much cheaper than lenses and were mainly used in movie theater projectors. As film distribution moved away from film and towards digital, tons of these adapters were rendered outdated and discarded. They end up on eBay or Craigslist for much less than their original prices, while some still deliver an image performance that secured them an Academy Award. A goal in this program is to pick up some anamorphic glass and rig it up to production standards. If you're going the adapter route, either for budget or versatility, there's way more to fiddle with to give you the same image quality and simplicity delivered by anamorphic lenses. If you lean more towards lenses, your path will be much easier, although it can cost a bit more. I had multiple conversations with Dan and Forrest from Atlas while working on this content, and one thing that kept popping up is the level of control you have over performance and design as you build the lens from the ground up, as opposed to piecing it together from various parts DIY style. You can really optimize each element and its role in making the image. The DIY path is for sure more engaging than just buying a ready solution, and you have more space to make choices such as flare color or focal length, but at the same time, it starts from a place of compromise as you're using multiple parts outside of their original intended use. So while they can work together well, there is no perfect setup. Now that we're good on the basic differences between lenses and adapters, next week I'll be talking about cine versus consumer lenses and how they play into your budget. To get that as soon as it's out, hit subscribe. If my distinction between lenses and adapters isn't clear, please leave a comment below and I'll do my best to answer your qualms. I know you're enjoying the Anamorphic Cookbook, so consider becoming a member of the channel to unlock extra benefits like early access to videos, as well as PDFs for each chapter in an awesome Discord server full of people on the same journey as you. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you next week. Chit Fahadungs out.